about it. All right, so we're starting a new section today on memory management, and that will be followed up in the next section by, followed up in the next section with virtual memory. So the next two sections. So this section is kind of an introduction, and well, this section really is about two-thirds of it is kind of dedicated to describing, which is kind of the case with these books, older, you know, no longer used memory management techniques. I kind of minimize your exposure or the time we spend on them, but this might be interesting. There's some interesting ideas presented, and I always consider the fact that, you know, while there, it's likely a few of you will be designing operating systems in the near future, there are some good ideas that can be applied to other types of systems, design of other types of systems. So, so memory management is, in this terms, is a set of operating system services that are responsible for something we talked about already, protection. So one of the important aspects from chapter two, I believe, was the idea that, you know, we have multiple processes running in memory, running on the system at the same time. And that is important that those, that each process be protected from access by other processes, because, well, the reasons we talked about, security, stability, and all of those ideas we talked about. Also, of course, a process cannot access the memory, the memory region in which the kernel has been installed, again, for the same reasons. So that's implemented, and we'll talk about how that is done in both. We already kind of talked about it, and we'll expand on a little bit how it's done in a more simpler, again, kind of out-of-date memory management techniques, and then how it's accomplished using paged virtual memory. Shared memory, the last couple of three slides in this section, we'll talk about the techniques for sharing memory between multiple processes. And so there's reasons for doing that. You know, generally speaking, if we just want to share information between two processes or between the kernel and the process, very fast, you know, the fastest possible mechanism for exchanging information between two processes or between the kernel and the process is a shared memory, and we'll talk about that. And then again, like I said, we're going to finish up also talking about paged memory. And then in the next section, we'll talk about virtual memory, and that's, you know, very relevant, entirely relevant to today's operating systems. A little bit about relocation. I don't want to spend a lot of time on it, but the idea is that here's an example. You know, you're familiar with this diagram. Each represents a snapshot of the system memory. A represents a newly initialized operating system, a system that's newly rebooted, I should say, in which we have the kernel installed in memory, but haven't yet created or installed any processes. Then here we have process one is created and it takes up a 350, and then process two is created. And I guess the one main feature is that each process, you know, has been assigned its own region of physical memory. And of course, those regions don't overlap. And in this diagram, and in many of these early examples, we'll talk about each partition, each region is, you know, contiguous, meaning that there's no breaks in it. So this contiguous range of memory is allocated to process two, and likewise for process one. And we have a free region of memory. So we have regions of memory which have not been allocated to a process. Now, especially if we're talking about batch processing, which we didn't talk too much about in chapter three, but, you know, if the operating system were to want to install a new or start a new process, it could only start a process whose size, whose image size would be less than 146K. And so if there are no processes, you know, that would fit in memory, fit in that region, then those processes, you know, there are no processes started, or only processes that can fit into this free memory, region of free memory, you know, it could be installed. Then in this example, what is going on also in this section, we're here anyway, process one is suspended. So let's kind of talk about it in the notes. But again, this is just an example of relocation. So for whatever reason, well, maybe because the, you know, again, this is really old operating systems, maybe because the operator had to run process three. Process three was an emergency, so to speak. And so through the operating system's commands, utilities, the operator, again, this is back in the day when computers were big, huge things and they had operators. They suspended process one. And so remember, suspended process isn't dead. Remember, the process exists both in memory and on system drive, which is not shown here. So while this process is no longer in memory because it's suspended, its image is still on the drive and can be, you know, reinstated, recopied into memory, you know, and continue its execution. So, but like I say, the scenario in this example is that the operator needed to run process three, and there was no memory for process three, no free memory, and so they suspended process one, and which freed up its memory, and then they started process three. And now we have process three and two running. And another thing, interesting thing to note is now we have two regions of free memory, which, you know, are in separate regions, in separate ranges of memory, obviously here and here. And so that'll come up in important, that'll be important later on. We talk about fragmentation, but here's two fragments of memory, free memory. And so process three is running, the process two exits, sorry. So process three is still running, but process two exits, and that frees up its memory. Now we're showing, you know, three ranges of memory, three regions of memory that are next to each other that are adjacent. And so this could be consolidated into a single region of memory, a single partition, which is kind of like what happens here. But for the time being, we're just going to, you know, show it as three regions of three partitions of free memory, three memory fragments, and moving on to here. Well, after process two exits, the operator decides to, you know, restart or unsuspend, I guess, better start, to resume process one. And so process one is loaded into this partition, this free partition, and but it doesn't occupy the entire partition. Remember, look here, the size is 350K, P1. And so they're free, this is a 400K partition, so that, you know, creates a P1 has been relocated. That's the whole section this slide was about. Process one then was running, and it was suspended, and it was reinstated and relocated from this region into this physical region of memory. And that created, and that, so that's the idea of relocation. A process can be moved from one region to another, relocated in memory. And to do that requires hardware support. We'll talk about that in a second. Requires memory management. And so finally, we have these three fragments to conclude the example. We have these three fragments of memory, free memory, and we want to consolidate them into a single region. And so to do that, we're going to the operating system, you know, has to copy, relocate this process up 50K so that it it doesn't necessarily overwrite, but utilizes this free region of memory between process three and then process one, as we see here. And that would, you know, free up that 50K and down here. And then we can consolidate, or the operating system can consolidate that, all that free memory into a single region of 246K. And that might be large enough to start process four. You know, that might 240K might be large enough to start a new process. Whereas if we'd left it unfragmented, each of these fragments or these partitions would not be large enough to start a new process, or likely. Whereas when we consolidate the partitions, the free partitions, by relocating, I guess another example, we've relocated this process a second time, relocated it from here to here, and then consolidated or the three, well, anyway, those free regions into a single region, into a single free partition. And again, we could start a new process perhaps in that. All right, so that's an example of relocation. We relocated process one from there to there. And then later when some sort of compression or consolidation was executed, the process P1 was relocated a second time up 50K. And giving us the opportunity to consolidate all of the system's free memory into a single free partition. Okay. Okay, so that was a lot of, you know, a lot of little examples there, a lot of details, and let's move on. The first idea that we attributed to memory management is the idea of protection. A process can't reference the memory that has been loaded with the memory. Oh, that's just a terrible sentence. Anyway, process cannot reference a memory that has been loaded with the memory instructions and data that has been allocated to another process. So again, what it amounts to is this process three's execution is constrained to the region of memory allocated to process one, to its process, whatever this address happens to be. It could be calculated pretty easily, but anyway, whatever that address says, and for whatever range, 350K for sure, the memory addresses that the processor is accessing is constrained to the beginning of P1's partition and for its length, or the end of the partition. And any attempt by the processor to read outside of its partition will generate an interrupt by the memory management hardware, will generate the interrupt, and the interrupt handler will terminate the process's execution. So both the other processes, but the simpler way to phrase it is just that the process is constrained to its own allocated partition of memory. So we need some hardware mechanism that can be used to facilitate both the protection and relocation. And a little review, if you recall, that we have each process image, P1, P3, so on, is divided into, in this primitive example, now this is for a single thread system. No, not multi-threaded, because if we had multiple threads, we'd have multiple stacks, but, you know, just trying to keep it simple for this. We have the program region, the text region, the instructions, and we have the heap that is allocated to the process, memory allocated. And then we have the stack. And again, excuse me, only a single stack per process in this example. One of the things to keep in mind is that we'll talk more about in a second, is that each process has a beginning, has an entry, if you will, and that we're going to call that logical address zero. And we're going to differentiate logical and physical addresses in just a few slides. But right now, the top of the process is logical address zero. Well, we're doing it right here. Logically, from the process's perspective, the process image appears as a single block of contiguous memory, a continuous memory. So the logical view, so it's just one region. Now, I mean, that seems obvious, but it'll be in a moment. We're going to talk about how when we get to paged memory, we'll see that really a process is spread throughout memory. And but we'll get back to that in a second. The logical view maintains the illusion that every process has an address space that is separate from all other processes. Every process is provided a logical address 0 to n, even though each image is located at a different physical address. For example, every process has logical address 100 that the processor can access, but through memory management hardware, the processor is actually accessing different physical address for every process. So what does that mean? I don't know if I should draw a picture or just use this one. So on this side, here's another snapshot of memory of memory operating system. Here's your processes. But now we're going to show two different types of addresses for this memory. We have the physical address, of the physical address for the memory, and then we have the logical address. So each process has its own logical address, although not shown here. Process 2 has a logical address that starts at here, at this physical address, and extends for however large that process is. So 0 through, in this example, for process 1, this process 1 has a logical address range of 0 to 350K, and this process has a logical address of 0 to... I'm not sure how big process 2 was, but 0 to however large this process happens to be. And so when the processor, let's do a diagram. Okay, I guess I can click on it. So here's our processor, and here is the the program counter. I'm going to draw over here. Program counter, the address that's being accessed. I could actually say, I don't want to confuse people, but remember the MAR, the memory address register, part of the, when we talked about the first section, the hardware section, we said that, the processor has a memory address register, which is the address, 64 bits, that the processor is currently reading or writing from. And of course, then we have memory. Let me scoot that over a bit. And then between the processor and memory, we have the memory management unit. And then on the other side of that, we have the actual memory itself. And kernel and process one. So we have the physical. If I would put physical on this side, I'll put logical, keeping with the other example. So when the processor is currently running process one, so this is the, this is that logical address. I didn't leave myself so much space here, 128. 000. So 128K, 128, 128, 000. And the size of the process, the duration is, 2K, although not drawn to scale. So it's going to be at 130. Well, let's make it 100K. So this to 228. So this is the base, and then the size or the limit. Well, with another example, 228,000. Or this is the 1,000 size. This is the size. Yeah. Okay. So my point is this. So that base and the size, or base and the limit, let's say base and size right here, that's loaded into the memory management. And every process has its own, you know, the process two has its own base and size, and process three, and so on. So when process two is running, you know, part of the context swap that occurs when the operating system swaps out one process, you know, after a timer interrupt, and so swaps out process I and brings in process J. Oops. The context switch. There's that period of time that the operating system is, you know, moving the old process out and moving the new process in. And part of the moving the process in is to copy the base and limit of the memory partition that the process has been loaded into the memory management hardware. And remember that information is loaded in the processor state of the processes process control block. So remember, every process in kernel has a process control block. So P sub I, or P1 in this case, has its base and limit register stored in the process control block within the kernel. So every memory reference produced by the processor is run through this memory management hardware. And so on this side is a logical address, and on this side is the physical address. And I have a diagram for this coming up. So this process is running, and it says, I want to load address 100. You know, whatever, I'm going to read or write to address 100. Now, address 100 is really stored at 128.100. You know, it's stored at 128. Plus 100 bytes in. So 100, 128, 100. I don't want to draw that in there. I'm just going to get too busy. But, you know, that is the physical address. The logical address is 100. I want to read 100, the byte 100 of this process. But physically, the memory location to be accessed has to be the base address plus the amount, you know, the offset defined by the address that, you know, the process is trying to actually access. So the processor, the application, says, I'm reading address 100, loads that into the memory address register, and then the address register will calculate the actual physical address using the base and size. Well, it needs the base address. It uses the size or limit register to determine whether or not the process is out of range. And that will produce the physical address, which is actually this 128.100, you know, right there. Okay, so that's what I'm just trying to get across. You know, every, you know, this is important, and we're going to copy this. This is going to follow us all the way through page memory into virtual memory. The idea that the process's image is installed at some physical location, some physical region in memory that has it a starting point and a size, but the process isn't aware of that address. The process works under, and the processor itself works under the illusion that every process has its own, you know, its own dedicated region of memory that starts at zero, logical address zero, and extends for however large the partition happens to be, the image happens to be. And so process two, is sitting at some address in memory, but it has logical address 0 and has a range of memory dedicated to it. Because process 2 has its own base and size, which is stored in the process control block, process 2's control block. All right, so that's the idea of logical and physical addresses and the role of the memory management hardware. We'll talk a little bit more about it. That's just the overview. Maybe see what the slides have to say about it. All right, so the same idea. So logically, every process is provided with the logical address of 0 to n, where n is the size of the partition, in this case, the size of the image. And we said this already. The process image is installed at a location, but actually, of course, the process image is stored at some location in physical memory. The memory region allocated to the process that was free when the process image was created. So all I'm just saying is when a new process is created, the operating system has to identify a region of unallocated memory, a free memory, that the new process image can be installed into. Because so that's the idea of free memory. The operating system has to track what memory is not currently allocated to a running process or to the kernel, and then allocate, if a new process needs to start, and hopefully there's free memory, and if so, the process image is created, into that new free, that range of memory, and then that memory is then allocated to the new process. In page memory, this is kind of a circular, but it's actually a contiguous pages, but we'll see when we get to that. A process could be relocated into different addresses without throughout its lifetime. It can be swapped out and swapped back in. Memory management maintains separate logical view of every process, when in reality, the process is loaded into physical memory shared by all processes. So same example here. So just did a second ago. Process 1 is located at location 128,000. And has a range of 350K, but it has a logical address of 0 through 350K. And then later on, as we the example we were doing before, where we relocated process 1 after process 2 exited, that same image is then located into physical address 5,000, but the process itself still maintains a logical address range of 0 to 350K. So, by the use of the base and limit registers, the logical address of 0 or 100 was initially maybe at this location. And when the processor tried to read 100, the memory management, offset that address to the location, the base address. And then here, again, when after being relocated, the same process attempts to read or write to address 100. And it's actually reading this memory range. But of course, the point is the process itself and the programmer who's writing that code is not aware of the relocation. The actual location of the process in memory, the physical address, the physical location, is not known nor should it be known to the processor. To the processor or to the developer who's having to write that code. I mean, this would be, relevant if you're using assembly language. Languages like C, and even more so with Java virtual machines, make all of that totally irrelevant. But if you were doing assembly language programming where you actually were, aware of the addresses where structures were stored in memory, then this becomes very relevant. I'm accessing a structure at address 100, static address 100, and whether that's at this location or at that location, the coder and the processor is not aware because the memory management hardware is automatically translating in real time the logical address of 100 into the physical address of 50,100. All right. Are any questions about that? All right. And then again, just like I showed a second ago, there's the memory management hardware, you know, makes that magic happen. Okay. Now, in reality, the processor maintains both the CPU, the processing, and the memory management hardware. So it's the circuitry, the transistors, if you will, are all on the same integrated circuit. But we're showing it, of course, showing it separately because it's easier to understand. And just to show, I mean, there's the idea of the base address and the bounds address. And, you know, we just went over that. Okay, any questions? So that's about that primitive memory management, or any questions before we move on? Going once, going twice. All right. Just to make sure, remember this. Remember that when we, that a process is imaged, and it kind of just went over, talked about that a second ago because we were talking about suspended. But, you know, when a process is created, the operating system will create the image. I'm going to draw it really big. You know, we'll create the process of I is being created, and the first thing that happens is the operating system constructs the image by, let's say we're going to run a program foo.exe. Well, foo.exe is an executable also on the disk, right? Yeah, and so that the text area, the instructions, and the data from that executable file, that's what that is, are copied into the image plus some other stuff. And the process control block is made and so on. But now we have an image on disk, and then the image, this is memory, has to be copied into a free unallocated region of memory, piece of I. And then once that's accomplished and the process control block is set up, then the processor, I'm not going to draw it, the processor can read or write to that. Of course, the processor can't access the data on memory, on disk. It has to be copied from disk into memory before the processor can access those instructions. Okay. All right. No questions. Just a little reminder, because that'll be really important in for virtual page virtual memory. All right. So now we're going to talk about the next couple of slides. Next several slides, we'll talk about older techniques of partitioning memory for or managing partitions of memory for processes. So. So again, just to make the point, let me go all the way back, all the way here. Each of these processes, each of these regions is a each of these regions is a partition of memory, which has been carved out of free memory, unallocated memory, and assigned to the process by the operating system. And each has a base and limit and so on and so forth. And so the idea is, how do these partitions manage? How are the partitions created? You know, and so that's what this section is about. You know, how does the operating system, you know, manage free memory? How does it carve out partitions of particular sizes from the available memory? And called partitioning. So a partition is a block of physical memory which a process image has been loaded for execution. So again, the partition is carved out of available memory. When the process is started, the partition is carved out of available memory allocated to the process, and the image is copied into it. The system's physical memory is divided into multiple partitions, and there's two different ways of managing memory partitions: fixed partitioning and dynamic partitioning. And just you know, these are just two different ways we'll talk about in a second. And both of them are, you know, very much, I hate to say this when we talk about my course, but they're very much out of date. But let's just, we're going to touch on them briefly. Both partitions types require a placement algorithm that determines which memory partition a process will be assigned to. So no partitioning. Back in the very earliest days, remember that section two, I showed you that big asshole computer, 701, that guy sitting in front of it. You know, the first IBM 701 was the first commercial CPU produced, made available, commercially available, the very first commercial computer. And the earliest operating systems to run on it, you know, didn't have memory management. It didn't have multiprocessing. It didn't have the idea of processes in general. The program was loaded into memory, and the program ran, and then the next program would be loaded. And after that program finished running to completion, a new program would be loaded into the same memory. So only a single program, a single process could run at once, there was no sharing. So there was no partitioning. All right, fixed partitioning. So then, you know, I mean, one of the reasons, you know, is, you know, early computers were built entirely from, you know, from transistors, and memory was core memory. If you're interested, you can look that up. Predates me, but it was a very there was very limited processing capabilities, processing speeds, and very, very limited memory. Now later on, you know, as semiconductors were introduced and memory became the semiconductor memory was created, dynamic RAM, we had more memory and operating systems evolved. So the earliest form of memory management had fixed partitions. So when the operating system was booted, through some configuration, I imagine, I have no experience, but you know, the operating system was partitioned into fixed regions of memory, partitions 1, 2, 3, 4. And within each region, a process could be installed. Process 1 could be running here, and 2, 3, 4, and so on. The partition sizes were fixed, though. So let me see, make sure I'm not going to. So if a process, I guess I could do a little picture here. Well, I'm not that interested in spending a lot of time on this at all, but we have partition. That looks terrible. We have, the OS, and then 8. Did I say 8 meg in that example, or was it 8K? No. Stick, oh, 8 meg, okay. 8 meg of partition, part, not process. This would be an A. Partition 1 and 2 and so on. And into that partition, a process image would be loaded. And so that process, let's go down here. So partition 2. We would load, you know, process I into it. Now the process was limited to the fixed size of the process. So in this example, we could not load a process image larger than 8 meg because it wouldn't fit into the partition. So maybe we want to load process J, and that's 6 meg, just to keep it simple. So process J would be loaded into partition 2, occupying 6 meg, and that would leave us 2 meg that is unused. So we could not load a process whose image size was larger than the fixed size, 8 meg in this case, and any memory that wasn't occupied. In this case, we have a 6 meg process being loaded into a 8 meg partition. And so that left us with wasting, so to speak, 2 meg of memory, which was pretty valuable in those days. So partition process J is located in this partition. And we have, 2 meg of unused, and this is called internal fragmentation. I'm not going to write it out. We'll just see it on the slide in a second. So our internal fragmentation is only present with fixed partitioning, and it represents the region of each partition that has a process loaded into it, and where the difference between the size of the process and the size of the partition, and it's essentially wasted memory, memory that is not going to be used. But of course, this is, this is just very old. So that's the idea, internal fragmentation. Then came more modern operating systems. And really, it's just driven by hardware. This fixed partitioning, it was basically implemented in hardware. And so, as hardware grew more sophisticated and memory management became more sophisticated, memory management became possible, the operating systems evolved into dynamic partitioning. So with dynamic partitioning, we can load a program, what we're talking about, at the beginning of the section. We initially have a blank slate, so to speak, a free memory. And then every process that is created is installed into a partition, which is dynamically created based on the size of the process to be installed. So this process image, process one, was 20 megabytes. So the operating system identified a free region of memory, which is basically all of it, that could fit that 20 meg image and dynamically created a new partition and install the process into it. And the same thing is true here. And a third time. So dynamically, three partitions were created that hosted three processes. And then we have a little bit of extra space here, 4 meg. And we can't fit anything in that. No processes to start that are, 4 meg or less. Then process, in this case, let me make sure process two is suspended because it comes back later. And in the same story, that frees up this range of memory, this partition that held process two is now a free range of memory. I wouldn't call it a partition because there's no image installed into it. So we'll just call it a free region of memory. And it's 14 meg, so we can install process four into it. And then it leaves us a hole of free memory here and a hole of free memory there. And then process one finishes or exits, freeing up its partition into free memory, and then partition process two, which was suspended, or is then reinstalled. And so that left us, with these three regions of unallocated memory. And this is called external fragmentation. These little regions of memory are called external fragments, or this is called external fragmentation. And the downside to them is that they're 6 meg and 6 meg and 4 meg. There's really no, maybe at this point in time, there's no process that is ready to run that will fit that memory. That is, smaller than 6 meg, smaller than the largest fragment available. So that's the idea of dynamic partitioning. Partitions are created, carved out of free regions of memory, dynamically created. They're created to be just large enough. Dynamic partitions are created to be just large enough to fit the image that's being installed. And so there's no internal fragmentation. Instead of internal fragmentation, which we had for fixed partitioning, dynamic partitioning suffers from external fragmentation. All right. And that's all, Sarah. Okay, any questions about that? Now we can compact those regions. That's what I was talking about before. didn't, I don't really have that image here, but compaction, it was, we had a previous example. You know, if we were to compact this memory, then we would, the operating system would relocate process 4 up 6 megabytes. And then process 3 would be relocated 12 megabytes, because that would be, you know, we'd have freed up a region of memory, 12 megabytes between 4 and 3. And then we would consolidate, so 4, 12, 16 megabytes would be created, a 60 megabyte free region would be created if we relocated or compressed, consolidated, all the existing images, and so they're all adjacent to each other. And again, consolidating all the free regions to a single region. And the idea then is that that 16 megabyte region, we actually might be able to install a new processor too. But that's really slow. You know, copying these, this 8 megabyte and this 18 megabyte region up and down, in this case, just up, you know, would be very slow. You know, take a lot of, even if it's done with direct memory access, if you remember that, you know, it might take many, maybe seconds, you know, for the processor or the DMA unit to copy this, you know, these two regions of memory. Okay, so it's expensive, it's slow, it's something to avoid. And with, you know, paged memory, paged virtual memory, you know, we no longer need it, so. Okay, so this is, you know, this is a topic that is, you know, it might be of interest, might be, you know, and this is an example of this placement algorithms, you know, is an example of ideas that might be, you know, in just general systems design. And you will most likely come across the idea of best and first fit, best fit and first fit in other situations, anytime we're trying to allocate or manage a resource, there is this idea of best and first fitting. And anyway, it's worth covering. So the problem is this. I thought I had a slide to cover that, but let's just do it. Okay, so a little example is in order. Let's do a new one. Okay. All right. Well, this is really close to being something we could use as an example without having me to copy it. So I can just copy it over. I'll just draw it by hand. Oops, why is that working? There it is. So here's memory. Let's duplicate that one right there. OS. And process 2, and then a free region, process 4, another free region, process 3. Another free region, so I have a free. All right, so we're going to talk about best first. Well, how are they covered in the slides? I think it's first is first. No, it's best. Okay, so for best fit, let's say we have a new image. So the idea of these algorithms, this is a placement algorithm, is when we have, where, you know, when we, or when the operating system needs to create a new process, it needs a region of memory, a free region of memory, to place the new image into. And so this is a very simple example. But so we have 6 meg here, 6 meg here, 6 meg here, and 4 meg here. And inside of these regions, we could place a new process if the process would fit. Well, just for the sake of argument, just for the sake of an example, we want to install a new process sub I, and it is 3 megabytes. Now, that's considerably smaller than these other processes, but again, we're just trying to come up with an example here. That's supposed to be a 6. So the algorithm, it will pick a partition that will is large enough to fit the new process. But the idea is we want to minimize external fragmentation. We want to minimize external fragmentation. So what does that mean? Well, we want to create the smallest external fragment as possible. So if we were just arbitrarily going to pick to put process I into this process, then we would carve out half of it, and we would process I in here, and then we would have a 3 meg partition. So we put three, process I requires 3 meg, we carve it out, and now we have a 3 meg partition. So we created 3 meg of external fragmentation, and that's not, we don't want to avoid it. We want to keep the external fragmentation to a minimum. So let me just control Z out of that. All right, so we'll talk about particular operators. So best fit, it kind of, as the name implies, is an algorithm, and the algorithm starts as kind of a search algorithm. It is a search algorithm. And so the operating system is going to scan each of the free partitions, and that information is managed separately in a kernel. I'm not going to show that here, but there's a map in the kernel that maintains the addresses of each partition, and then by default, but then either explicitly or implied, the location and size of each free fragment, each free region, not occupied by a partition, by a image. So it begins at the beginning. It's a search algorithm. So it begins at the first, at the top, so to speak, and scans through and identifies an algorithm, a placement that is going to be the best fit. By best, we mean minimizes external fragmentation. So 6 will work, so I'm just kind of talking it through now. So it looks at this part, fragment 1, and says, oh, that'll work, but, is it the best? Well, it's the only way it can know it's the best is if it looks at all of them. So it looks at the second 6, well, it's another 6, so okay. And then looks at 4. And so of all the candidates, 6, 6, and 4, 4 is the smallest while still fitting the process. And so process 3 will be carved out. I can't run, it's just too small. 3 is placed in here, and still that will create a 1 megabyte partition. A 1 megabyte external fragment. But that's the minute we wanted to minimize the external fragmentation. So by picking the smallest free region that is large enough to hold a new process, we have done that. We have accomplished that goal. Created the least amount of external fragmentation. But it was expensive, because here we only have 3 fragments. But then if you have a lot of memory, there might be thousands of fragments, or hundreds anyway, maybe thousands of fragments that to be scanned. And in fact, like I said a moment ago, this is not really how it works in page memory. But the point is that, you know, best fit produces the least amount of fragmentation, but takes the longest because every free region must be examined in order to determine. And there's optimizations, we could sort them and all that. But that takes time too, you know, it takes processing overhead. And just to make a point, you know, we want to, an overall goal of operating systems is to minimize the amount of time, the number of processor cycles that is needed to support the operating system. So yeah, we could maintain this list of free fragments in a sorted list or a tree, but then we would have to maintain the tree. Every time a fragment is created or consumed, the operating system memory management section would have to rebalance, you know, modify and rebalance that tree. And that takes time, you know, that takes processor cycles. And so we want to minimize the number of processor cycles that operating system consumes, because kind of, you know, from a user's perspective, they're wasted. You know, I'm buying an expensive system to run my application, to crunch my numbers, to run my game, whatever the reason is. And the more time, the more cycles dedicated to the operating system, you know, the less cycles the system has for serving whatever purpose, you know, it serves in the user's life. So, and that's, you know, that's one reason. So, you know, that's kind of the underlying motivation. So that's best fit. Best fit scans them all. Well, I think you can pick up on the idea of first fit. You know, it'll do the scan and it'll pick the first partition that is large enough to hold the new image. So we're looking at 3 megabytes. Starts the scan, 6 megabytes right here. We'll pick that one. So the process I goes in here and we carve out another free partition of 3. Now we have a 3 from 6 to 3, just like the previous example, you know, from not the best fit, but before that, you know, we go from a free region of 6 is now a free region of 3 because I is now in there. But we've, you know, we've created 2, I don't know, we've wasted, it's hard to say, but we now have we did minimize external fragmentation. You know. So that's first fit. First fit is efficient because it just takes the first one that's large enough, but, you know, is not very efficient. Then there is next fit. So next fit is like first fit, except that the scan doesn't start at the top. We said that it's a search algorithm. Essentially, these placement algorithms are all search algorithms. And best fit and first fit always start at the top of memory, so to speak, and scan to the bottom. Best fit scans everything. First fit just scans to find something. And the next fit is first fit, so it doesn't just, but the scan begins where the last scan left off. So if you started at the top just to start someplace, and we allocated process I, and we, you know, carved out 3 megabytes, and that left us 3 megabytes of memory, the next scan would start here. So the first scan started here and located that fragment right there, created I, and so the next scan, next fit, starts the next scan, the next allocation, where the last allocation, the previous allocation left off. And so instead of starting back at the top, next fit will start, you know, there, because that's where the last fragment was identified. And it'll scan. So if the next partition is looking for another, let's say 2 megabytes, it would continue and carve it off of this one, and so on. So the next fit, the purpose of next fit is it more, the partitions are more evenly distributed through the entire range of memory, where with first fit, it always starts at the top and moves down. I believe the motivation is it'll begin to create very small fragments high in memory, And so it'll spend more and more time searching deeper and deeper to the memory region of memory, taking more time because it's going, again, by its nature, it's creating a lot of very small fragments at the top of memory, because it always starts from the top. And each scan that it has to go progressively deeper and deeper and deeper into memory before finding a free region that's large enough to host the new process. Where with NextFit, it always starts where the last one left off. And so that fragmentation will be more evenly distributed throughout memory. And the scan won't take as long. Individual scan, won't take as long, won't have to cover as much memory. Okay, so BestFit gives us the best allocation of memory, but takes a very long amount of time because the entire region of memory has to be scanned for each allocation. FirstFit is good, is fast, but creates a lot of small fragments and always seems to create them at the top upper region of memory. And also spends more and more time. Each scan takes more and more time, has to go deeper into memory. Where with NextFit, each scan begins where the last one left off. And so each scan is much shorter and there's less, and the fragmentation is distributed evenly throughout memory. So anyway, like I said before, not relevant to operating systems, but I think, is an interesting algorithm that you might have use for in a more general systems design. That's all I see. All right, let's see if I can do that. Yeah, that works. Okay. All right. Dynamic partitioning eliminates internal fragmentation, but introduces external fragmentation between processes. I said that already. So, all right. Problem in general with memory partitioning. One second, please. All right. Sorry. All right, so just as a read, I'm going to start page memory. But fixing dynamic partitioning results in wasted memory due to internal or external fragmentation. Dynamic partitioning has the overhead of allocating new partitions and compressing freed partitions at runtime. So again, once we have a lot of external fragmentation, a lot of external fragments, we have to begin consolidating them together. And we could talk, there's techniques for doing that. The book talks about some of them, but again, I don't want to spend any more time on it here. Dynamic partitioning requires constant relocation of processes, images. Here's another interesting problem with both, but let's cover that here. Let's cover it, here. A little space here. So, for example, when one of the, someone might have noticed that these examples sort of imply a fixed image size. We're saying that when process I is created on disk and then in memory, it has a fixed size, let's say 8 megabytes, just because. But that's not really how programs run, right? The program might start with, this is example, running another example down here. The process might start, process J might start with, 2 meg of memory and then do mellux. It's going to allocate memory. That's quite a, programs spend, they'll start small, as I'm sure you're all aware, I've seen that, or experienced it in memory leaks in your own program. But, it starts at a certain, image starts at a certain size, but then it grows larger as each malloc, as each, as memory is allocated and by the process. So if we have processes that are, in this contiguous range of memory, maybe we have process two. So here's process one and process two. Well, process one is in a 8 meg partition, but it performs a bunch of mallocs and it grows beyond 8 meg. Well, in this example, what can we do? We can't grow the size of this partition any further because it's bumping up against P2. So we have to do one or two things. We'll have to move P2 somewhere else. We'll have to do a relocation one way or the other. We relocate partition one into a region where it has space to grow into. So move it from there to there. Or we move partition two, I'm sorry, process two into another re a region and freeing up this region. So process one has room to grow into. But either way, this is, extremely problematic. Where every time a process grows beyond its current partition size, it has to be, expensively relocated, or the process, the memory has to be expensively reorganized in order to free up memory, free up adjacent regions of memory that the process can grow into. So that's just, really problematic, and but totally unnecessary for, as we'll see, for page memory. All right, so page memory. So what we have, let's see if we have a diagram here, right here. So what it amounts to is the process image will now be spread across multiple regions of memory, across a physical memory. So we have two ideas. We have pages and frames. So physical memory, we're not showing the operating system here, but this is physical memory, again, without, and it's divided into equal sized regions of memory. And this is like, these are like fixed partitioning, from way back from the beginning of the first thing we talked about, fixed partitions. But these are fixed partitions. And in operating, modern operating system, these are 4,000 bytes, 4096, or 2 to the 12 bytes. So frame, the first 4,000 bytes is frame one, frame zero, frame one, frame two, and so on. And not shown here, so let's draw a picture. Why not? Let's try another one. What the heck, huh? Okay, so here's memory. And here it is divided into frames. I'm trying to be a little consistent here. So frames, F. Okay, I'm doing zero before, so F0, F1, and so on. Now let's look at the memory. Let's look at the image on disk. Remember the on the disk of the drive, the image is created, and it's divided into pages, but actually blocks. Now we'll talk about this coming up later, but the drive itself is far, is well, not physically, but logically divided into chunks called blocks. And so we read and write data for, to and from a disk in chunks called blocks. And the size of the block just also happens to be 4K. So the size of the block is equal to the size of a page, is equal to the size of a frame, memory frame. So because of the block size, the memory image process sub I is has an image size of, let's say, I don't know, 10 megabytes, but it's divided into these equally sized chunks, and these are called pages. So page zero, page one, page two, and so on. So when we said before that the operating system will transfer the image on disk into memory, what in this example or in this strategy and in virtual memory, what's being transferred is each page. Page zero is copied from image, from disk, and so this will be process I, page zero, process I, page one, you know, and page two. So I, three, and so on. So that's how it works. The process image on disk is stored in blocks, but 4K chunks, and then each of those pages is copied from disk into a unallocated frame in memory. So at this point in time, let's say we had 2, 3, 4 pages. That's a very small program, but just because. And then at this instant in time, these are all free, the remaining pages. There's nothing in those pages, so they're unallocated. And so let's go back to this slide. And so that's what we're seeing here. And I'm not showing the disk, obviously, not showing the disk and so on, but you know, those disks, those pages are being copied from the drive. And so we have process A, page 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Or OMO 23, and then underneath that we've installed, or the operating system's installed, a second process B, which has 3 pages, and then here, a little hard to read, but process C. And then these are free. But here's kind of the interesting thing, we'll see how this works in a second, is, you know, let's say process B exits, you know, freeing up its frames. So process B exited and its image was removed from the drive, and any pages stored from process B are removed from memory, from their frames. And so with B's disappearance, that freed up these 3 frames. Now here's the very interesting and kind of powerful thing, is that now we're going to start process D, and it has an image on memory, and it occupies 5 frames. Well, we can install those pages anywhere in memory. They don't have to be, although these 3 examples were contiguous, A0, 1, 2, 3, they don't have to be. And as kind of demonstrated here, process D's first 3 pages are allocated to the first 3 free frames. And then the remaining 2 pages are allocated into the another 2 frames in memory. But it doesn't have to be like that. I mean, here we're putting A0 here, but we could have, you know, A0. I don't want to draw on the image, but we could put A0 here, or we could put A1 here, and A2 here, and A3 there. So a process's pages can be placed into any free frame that currently exists in memory, and they don't have to be contiguous. They can be, you know, placed anywhere. And we'll see in a second, there's an address translation mechanism that, you know, makes that work. Okay, so frames and the size of a frame is fixed by the hardware, the memory management hardware. Although that's not entirely true, and if you really dig down deep into how this thing works, the memory management hardware actually supports different size pages, but we're always going to stick with 4K here. And then again, the process and image is the process image on disk is divided into pages, which again falls into this idea of block sizes. And then the pages are copied into unoccupied frames, and then once in memory, they can be accessed. How does that work? Well, you know, in the previous dynamic partitioning example, we said that every process has a base and limit register that determined its location in memory. So if you understand that, then consider the idea that each with paged memory, we have every process is assigned a page table. And so this is a array in memory, probably in, you know, the process control block, that maintains the addresses that of the frame. Okay, sorry. But yeah, it contains the address of the frame that the page is stored in. So, you know, the page number, it comes down to the translation, just like before, the translation of a logical address that the processor, you know, is attempting to load. Like we said before, through memory management, every process, well, there are two types of addresses. There's the logical address that of the processes that the process is running in. If you consider assembly language, it kind of makes sense. Again, if the process is attempting to read logical address 100, then that logical address will be translated, we'll talk about in a second, into a page, and then the page will provide, well, the page table entry will provide the base address that address is stored in, and then the offset from that address is used to index into that frame or into that page to give us the actual address. So to make that work, the logical address is divided into two regions, the offset and then the page number. Now the offset, the length of the offset region is the size of a frame, the size of a page, but they're both the same if you remember. So we said before that the size of the frame is 4096 or 2 to the 12. So 2 of 12 bits, you know, holds, you know, a number from 0 to 4095. So that is that determines the offset, the first bits. Okay. And then the remaining bits, you know, the size of the frame determines the size of the offset bits, the number of offset bits. And then whatever bits remain, so this is bit 0 through 11, 2 to the 12, 12 bits. We'll say 1 through 12, then bit 13 through whatever, 64, is used to address the page number, is used to index into the processes page table. So if we're accessing this number, let's say we have, in this example, we have a very small address range, only 64 bits. Now, modern processors are 64 bits. But for the example, this is a 16-bit address. Every address is 16 bits long. So this is all done in hardware. You know, this is all accomplished. Well, yeah, it's all done in hardware. The operating system really does not. The operating system manages the page table, but it doesn't. It has no role in this address lookup, this translation from a logical to a physical address. So, the processor. Just to make sure it's clear. I'm not sure if I still have those. Yeah, right here. The processor presents a logical address to the memory management hardware, and then the memory management hardware processes that, producing a physical address that addresses the actual byte in memory that is then read back, you know, that is returned to the processor, you know, for a read. So from logical to physical with the memory management in the middle. Same thing here. This is what is going on here is the memory management. All right, so now this is, you know, if you have questions, let me know. This is kind of, I'm not going to say it's tricky, but I always think it's tricky. And you know, as far as the course goes, it's one of the trickier concepts. So how does that logical to physical address occur? Well, Again, the memory is split in the address that's presented, the logical address presented by the processor is divided into two regions. This is all done in hardware. The low order bits we'll come back to in a second. The higher order bits now form an index, basically an index into an array of page table entries. Each page table entry maintains the starting address of the physical starting address, the physical address of the, of the frame. The first byte of each frame in physical memory is stored in this, in each page table entry. So this, at for the first address zero, page number zero, would be that address right there. And this address, page address one, is that address. Now this is in physical memory, so this might be, some lag. This is just some location of memory, some frame. That frame there or that frame there, each of these is, this is a zero, this is four, this is eight, this is 12, 16, and so on, 24, 32. That's the address, 42, 0K, 4000, 8000 address, 12,000, 16,000, 4,000 bytes. So physical address 0, physical address 4,000, physical address 8,000, 12,000, 16, and so on. That's what's stored in the page table entry. And the high order bits index into this array. That gives us the base address. And then, although that's not exactly how it happens, just for the sake of example, at this moment in time, the base address is added to the contents of the offset, the offset part. So if this is address 8,000, and we're trying to read address I want to say 100. I'm using example of 100. This is address, something larger than 4,000. 4,100, really. I guess I have to go with it. I want to write on the slide. Want to address 404196. So I want to address the 100th byte into the second frame, more or less. 4196. Well, that extends beyond. That number will be, the logical address will be, see, the problem here is it's just such a large example, and I'm not even sure I need to do it. This is the offset, and this is the page number. So if I'm looking to read 4196, well, that's going to be, 10000, and then this will probably be all zero. Let's say 4200. Anyway, this is what I'm saying is it's going to be maybe draw this a little more distinct. Offset on this side, page number on this side. It'll be one on this side, and then it'll be an offset bytes into 4096 minus 4200 minus 4096, whatever that happens to come out to, that will be the offset. The offset into the page or the frame, really, identified by the higher order bits. So the higher order bits, you know, gives us the page number, and the low order bits gives us the offset into the page that's identified by the higher order bits. And the base address, again, each of these frames has a base address of the frame that the page is stored in, and that offset is added to that base address, which gives us a offset into the frame. This has that address, and the low order bits, or the high order bits, gave us that page number. And that page number contained this frame address, and then the low order bits was added to the frame address to give us an offset into that page, which is the actual address that the processor is trying to read. And you know, I've tried doing examples on the slide of, you know, showing the zeros and the ones, and it's just got, you know, too crazy as well. It's kind of an intuitive idea. Can anyone ask a question to illustrate that you understand it or not? Give me a problem? Still out there? 19 of you? So this is not good. No questions? Well, I don't know. All right, let's move on and maybe come back to it. Maybe I'll try putting together another example for next time. Where am I on time, by the way? All right, so each page, each process has its own page table, okay? Each process is allocated a certain number of frames. So here we have a page table. Again, it's like an array, and the higher order bits of each address, the page number offset, page number of each address is used to index into the array that is the page table. And so this corresponds to this example here, where we had frame 0, 1, 2, 3 allocated to process A. And so, you know, just see the problem with this example is if you want to know what this number is, what you really want to do is you take the frame number. This is helpful. Take the frame number and multiply times the size of a frame. 4096. So what's the base address of frame 2? Well, it's 4096, 2 times 4096, you know, and 3 or 100. But, you know, if we want to know the base address of any frame, we take that address, multiply it by 4096, and that gives us the physical address of that frame in memory. So maybe that makes sense. So the first frame in memory, physical address 0. The second frame in memory, physical address 4096, and so on. The ninth frame in memory, 9 times 4096. That gives us the physical address of the ninth frame in memory. And then that frame, that physical address of the frame is added to the offset portion that gives us the actual physical address of the word that the processor is attempting to read or write to in memory. The logical address is translated into a frame number, a frame base address using the page table, and then the lower order bits are added to that address or combined with that address and give us the actual address in physical memory where the processor is attempting to read or write from. And every process has its own allocated set of pages. And at this point in time, we're going to say that every process has its own distinct set of frames, is allocated its own frame. So as kind of showing here, no two processes are sharing the same frames. But this makes management pretty easy. Now, when we're managing free lists or free memory, we don't have to do any consolidation or compression like we were doing with dynamic memory. We essentially allocate a frame to a process, or we free the frame and becomes a free frame to be allocated to another process. So this is greatly simplified. What else do I have to say? I have some other ideas, but I don't want to jump too far ahead. Here's another example. I was trying to duplicate a moment ago and I forgot this is here. Here's the 16-bit logical address, and we have a 10-bit offset, and we have a 6-bit page number, because you know this is 10 bits is our frame size, so that's 1024, and that leaves us a remaining 6 bits. It's not 2 to the 12 in this example, it's 2 to the 10 in this example, just to make sure we're not confusing. And then this address, this higher order bits, indexes into the process's page table, and that gives us the binary address of the base address of the frame that the logical address is indexing into. And so that is used to build the physical address. So this is, you know, here we showed an adder. You know, adding is really an expensive operation. You wouldn't want to do that for every memory address. You wouldn't want to use a math adder, an adder unit to do a logical to physical address translation. What we could do now is, because these numbers are of a fixed size, we can just concatenate them together. So from the logical address, the higher order bits is used to index into the page table, which gives us the bits, the higher order bits, the base address of the frame's physical address in memory, the base address. And then we concatenate, the hardware concatenates the lower order bits with that address. See here, 000110 right there. And we concatenate the lower order bits, the offset bits, with the base address of the frame, and that gives us the actual physical address. That gets us to that address. So this adder is really basically a concatenation of these bits with the lower order offset logical address bits. When concatenated together, gives us essentially is adding. It is an add operation, but using binary, and gives us the actual physical address. So hopefully that makes sense. 10-bit frame, this has a 1,000 byte frame size, page size, frame size, both the same. It's a 16-bit logical address. The processor is a 16-bit processor. So that gives us 6 bits for the page offset, page number, which is an index into the page table, which gives us the high order bits of the base address of the frame that the page is stored in. And those high order bits is concatenated with the offset into that frame. And that gives us the actual logical address that the processor is trying to read or write into. And this is very fast because we're just basically concatenating one register and we're loading this 16-bit memory register with the high order bits from the page table and the lower order bits from the logical register, and that can be done very, very quickly. The only thing that's expensive, and we'll see later, is this offset, because this lookup actually happens in memory. But we'll come back to that in the next section. But it's a very fast, very efficient process for translating the logical to a physical address. Any questions? All right. I mean, this has been the, I mean, I said before I was trying to duplicate this example. I was working on something else before the class started. This is essentially what I would, you know, was trying to put together before. This is exactly. So if you have questions about this translation, because it gets more complicated when we get to virtual memory. So if you're not grokking this right now, you're going to have a difficulty in the coming section. So if you have any questions, you know, answer them now. That'd be nice. Or, you know, write me. Okay, so to simplify the translation, the page table size is powers of 2, allowing the offset to be fully maintained by m bits. And so because these are all these numbers, 16-bit the address, and everything is binary, we can do addition by simply concatenating these two strings together, these two strings of bits together to add the offset, the base address of the frame with the offset into the frame. So that's very, very efficient. This is just what I've said before. Order bits is logical address, is a frame offset, producing a physical address by concatenating the frame's base address with the frame offset. Importance of power of 2, I'm just saying is this concatenation works because everything, you know, both the size of the frame and the size, the processor's word size are all powers of 2, which of course would have to be because this is binary. But, you know, we just are able to concatenate the base address with the frame address, the frame base with the offset, and get us to the physical, the actual physical address. And this can be done very quickly in hardware. All right. So simple paging, the qualities of simple paging, the partitions, frames are very small, 4,000 bytes, or in this example, 1,000 bytes, but in reality, 4,000 bytes. Each frame assigned to the process is maintained in the process's page table. A process image occupies multiple frames. You know, process image occupies multiple pages, and so are copied into multiple frames. The frames occupied by the image need not be contiguous. So as we said before, we can store, this doesn't have to be contiguous. This could be A0 stored here and A1 here and A2 and A3, because each page, the base address of this frame and that frame 6 and so on, that's stored in the process's page table. And translated into the actual, you know, logical address is translated into the appropriate frame. So the frames can be placed anywhere. The pages can be stored in any frame in memory, any location of memory, and certainly not have to be contiguous. Where am I? Paging produces no external fragmentation. And a small amount of internal fragmentation in some frames. So some frames may not, the process, the size of the image may, is, you know, very unlikely, is often, is always really, you know, less than an evenly divided number of 4096. So the last, you know, logically the last page of every program is not fully occupied. In fact, as it turns out, not every page might be fully occupied. But there is a certain amount of internal fragmentation when a program doesn't utilize an entire frame. But this is really pretty small, and the benefits of paging far outweigh the idea that certain frames are not fully occupied by the process page. So small amounts of internal fragmentation, but nothing that we're going to worry about. But the idea, this coming back to something we talked about before, is that, I'll just go back here, is if we look at this right here, let's say right here, process D. So process said before, one of the problems with dynamic partitioning is that if a program, you know, programs grow, they malloc, they allocate new memory. So if program D or C, it really doesn't matter. You know, if any of these programs allocate more memory and outgrow the frames that they currently reside in, then memory allocation becomes requesting the operating system, memory management, for a free frame, and then appending that new frame to the processing's page table. So let's stick with D. Now let's go with C, right? I like it better. So process C occupies, but depending on what you're using, 32K of memory. And it wants to grow. It wants to allocate another 1,000 bytes. And so we can't fit it into the existing frames that's been allocated. So we get a new frame. The operating system makes a request, or, you know, doesn't really make a request. It identifies a free frame, which is pretty easy to do. And then, so that new frame, let's say 13. So then 13 will now be added to the process's C's page table, and then 13 will be allocated to C. So that would check, this would be, you know, C4, will be in this. And then we go back to that page table. Process 13 will be removed from the free list and will be the fifth entry in process D's page table. So again, process D wants to allocate more memory. It won't fit into the existing pages, existing frames. So the malloc made by process D triggers the operating system to identify a free frame, which is just maintained in the list. That frame 13 is removed from the list, is added to process D's page table at the fifth element as a fifth entry, and now the memory region allocated to process D has been expanded by, in this case, let's say 4,000 bytes. So memory could be added and removed very quickly, very easily, and we have none of that problem with relocating a process when its partition grows, you know, into another partition, another existing partition that we talked about earlier. Okay, so the last thing to talk a little bit about is shared memory. So any questions about page memory right now? Okay, so shared memory is the idea that, and this is a little bit common. I mean, you can come across this. So with shared memory, let's say we have two processes. So I'm back to showing just, you know, solid regions, although this could be page memory. So process one and process two, just to keep it simple. Make it a little bit smaller. And so with shared memory, we want to process one to share data with process two. And without process, without shared memory, these two processes, you know, can't share data through memory. They have to send it through a pipe or a socket or some other inter-process communication. Remember, IPC stands for inter-process communication. So how does process one and process two share information? They want to share data. Well, what the operating system offers is the ability to create another region of memory. Maybe I should have shown this horizontally. I think that was a mistake. Although it helps to show it here this way too. But say here's process one, process two. Now again, we want to process one and process two want to share some information, and so process one and process two are both written to create or share a shared memory region, a region of shared memory. So what it amounts to is through an, we'll talk about this in a second, through a through an API call, through a syscall, system call, operating system service, the one of the two processes creates a new region of memory, call it SM for shared memory. And then logically, through the system calls, both processes essentially append SM to their in-process image. So logically, this shared memory region has been mapped into this process image. So essentially the size of the process image has grown by, let's say, 1 megabyte. And the size of this image has grown by 1 megabyte. So the process, the logical address, this new region of memory is in the logical address map of both processes. But it's the same physical memory. So if this process writes a little bit of data into a structure here, it's basically storing it into that region, physical region right there. And because both processes have mapped that, those pages really, that region of memory into their image, well then this process sees it itself. So this process can read that data, this process writes that data, this process reads that data, and vice versa. This process writes, this process sees. Any change made to by one process to into the, in this shared region of memory is picked up by the other process because they both have mapped the same pages, the same region of memory, into their page table, into their process image. Why is this a, you know, a good thing? You know, why not just use a network socket? You know, so it's because it's just so much simpler. Well, because it's really, really, I mean, it's as fast as you can get. It's as fast as it can go. So although I'm not an expert on graphics processing units, I know that if this was the, you know, if this was a process and it's attempting to transfer meshes or texture maps and stuff to the GPU, to the graphics, you know, I understand how it works is the, under the covers, the client process, the process trying to manipulate the GPU maps a region of memory that is shared with the graphics driver, and they can write data. This process can write mesh and other information into a shared region of memory, and the driver just picks it up automatically, and then, you know, presents it onto the, renders it on the screen as, you know, as whatever. So the point is that shared memory is very, you know, is as fast as mechanism possible to exchange information between two processes. And that's it. That's the advantage. Okay. So how it's accomplished though is, you know, the when the page table, so for process one and process two has their own page tables of frames, we said this one was smaller, so this has frame 1, 3, 5, 10, and this has pages 6, 8, and 9, just because they don't share. But then when shared memory occurs, a new frame is occupied, frame 30 is set aside, and then that page table is extended with 30 and with 30. So now the page table of both processes share the same frame, the same physical memory. And again, so the effect being that when one writes into that frame, the other process sharing the same frame in their page table, you know, has access to that shared same physical memory and sees whatever changes are made one way or the other. Okay. So frames of memory shared between two more processes, multiple processes have the same memory frames mapped to their table, their images. And so when memory contains buffers, structures, arrays, two or more processes. And this can do three processes or four processes. I'm showing two, but we could have a third process, although it might be kind of rare. Oops, I missed it. Where is it? Oh. Process three could join the party. Process three could request through the syscalls. Say, hey, I want to attach to that shared memory segment as well. And it'll get it. So now all three processes can exchange data. So how does that work? Again, I'm not going to show any detail, but the operating system in Linux and POSIX, Linux provides a system called shared memory open. And so that gives it a name. So, you know, the all processes that want to attach to the same shared memory segment have to be aware of whatever that name happens to be. We said before SM, you know, so they all three are, let's just say two, all two, both processes, you know, open the same name, a segment with the same name, SM or shared memory 123, doesn't matter. And they both get back a file descriptor, of that shared memory. And then they use, each process uses a system called memmap or memory map. And that will map, that will cause this shared memory segment to get mapped into their image. And that basically updating the page table, I assume. Then a return, mmap will return a pointer to the shared memory segment that then the process can run, use to read or write into that data structure. So it's a little, you know, it's a little more complicated than I'm making it sound, but essentially shared memory, like I didn't show the size here. Somebody has to specify the size of the segment, and I'm not showing, you know, one of the processes that are participating in the shared memory has to specify how big a shared memory segment do we want? Do we want 1K, 2K, 100K? You know, one frag, you know, it's up to someone has to specify that. Anyway, mmap will return a pointer to the mapped memory, just like with malloc. And then the program can, you know, a C program can then use that pointer to reference that region of memory and it could read, you know, map it to an array or a struct. You know, I'm getting back into C programming and pointer arithmetic and so on, but then can access that memory and then, of course, like I said, every process writes into that region of memory. You know, other processes could read from that region of memory and see the changes and so on. One of the things, just to wrap it up, one of the things that is important is to minimize the amount of memory that is allocated to a process. So another use for shared memory. So let's go back here. We'll say we have a program that we are creating, an image that we're creating. And the process, you know, process Sabai is creating a new image. And this is the text, the instructions, like I for instructions, and the data and the heap too, but I'm sorry, the control stack. But also then, you know, when we create a program, you know, we need certain libraries. You know, if we're writing a C program, you should, you know, we're not going to do that in this course, but, you know, but for your C++ days, remember that, you know, you had to link in, I hope you showed that, covered that. You had to link up some standard libraries in, so libc and libio. And there's a libnet and so on. So libc contained things like free and malloc, and libio contains read and write and printf and so on. So these libraries have to be linked into the process image. The content, so these, each of these libraries contains instructions and data as well. And its own libio maintains its own instructions and data. And so these have to be mapped into libc and libio have to be mapped into the process image, P sub I. And then process two, P1, also has its own, you know, instructions and data from the, you know, from the compiled program, but also will need access to libc and libio. So, you know, what that kind of implies is that when this program, the process image is created, you know, part of the information in the exe file, you know, the file created by the linker, is all of the libraries that that program will access. You know, libc is needed, libio is needed, libnet is needed, libmath is needed, and so on. And then those libraries are linked, are combined into the image so that when the program accesses or does a, you know, does a malloc, it could get access to those instructions that were in the libc library. libc.so for Linux users, or DLL for, you know, Windows. So if that's understandable, then let's consider the idea that, you know, every program needs libc. Every program, just about really, every program needs libio. And so if I'm running 1,000 processes, then this brute force simplistic method has 1,000 copies of libc installed in memory, installed in that process's image. And that, you know, would be, you know, very, very wasteful. So, you know, one of the features of the library is that the program reads the instructions, but the program doesn't update. No, these are read-only regions of memory. You can't, the program cannot write into the memory that contains a library. So with that restriction, what it amounts to is that instead of every process having their own copy of these libraries in their process image, these instead, each library is mapped into a shared memory segment, libc, libio. So physically in memory, a set of frames that this library, these libraries are copied from disk into physical memory, and then they're, you know, then they become shared memory segments, shared memory frames. And then every time a process is created, those frames are mapped into the process image. Same thing here. So shared memory is used to build, to copy, well, to, okay, shared memory is used to provide each process, to provide each process their own copy of the text, you know, the instructions, the data, you know, contained in those libraries. But because these the instructions and data are placed into their own, you know, are copied once into a physical region of memory, into a set of frames, and then those frames are mapped into every process that needs access to that library, we physically maintain a single copy of the library in memory, and then every those 1,000 processes are all sharing the same frames or using shared memory to gain access to that single set of frames. And so, you know, reduces the footprint of the library from, you know, 1,000 copies of libc to a single copy. And of course that would be, you know, that's very important to manage the memory used by the operating system. Okay, that's it. If there's no questions, that's all we have for today. And then so on Tuesday, well, tomorrow, of course, is the midterm. I'll be on hand from 1 to 7, sitting here doing something else. Well, actually, I think I'm going to start on the next project for this course. And so I'll be busy doing that. And so if you have any questions, you can team me, call, you know, get hold of me on team if you have any questions about the questions on the exam. And other than that, best of luck with it. And any questions? Well, that's it for today. And I'm going to touch on this memory mapping again. I'm going to think about it again. And then we're going to get to virtual memory. And it gets even more complicated. But that's the way it is. All right. Thanks for your attention. Thanks for attending class today. And again, let me know if you have any questions. Best of luck tomorrow. And we'll see you again on Tuesday.